just about everything we know about the universe actually comes from spectroscopy. And just imagine what we do know but wouldn't if spectroscopy didn't exist. We wouldn't know about the expansion of the universe. We wouldn't know very much about stars at all. We wouldn't probably know about extrasolar planets. Maybe we would, but we wouldn't have known about extrasolar planets as early as 1995. Anyway, this talk is in two parts. The first part, I'm going to give you a basic primer of stellar spectroscopy 101, just the basic physics which is involved. And the second half of my talk, I'm going to tell you about some of the amazing discoveries that stellar spectroscopists have made. And I'll be focusing on the last three decades of the 20th century. Here is a picture of portraits of 22 famous stellar spectroscopists. And if anyone can recognize them all, they'll get a chocolate fish. let's change that. If anyone can recognize even one, can anyone put a name to any of those faces? Ellington was not a spectroscopist. He was entirely theoretical and hardly ever touched a telescope. No, Ellington is not there.
My guess, Celia Payne.
She's not there either, but she's, she should have been. Probably the most famous guy is this one. W.W. Morgan, William Morgan, who not only invented the UVB system, but was did a lot of work in spectral classification. All the others are not that famous, actually. George Herbig was a pretty important American spectroscopist, and he is they're both deceased. Most of these people are deceased. These last two got the Nobel Prize for inventing the CCD detector, which has played a very important role. Willard Boyle, who died recently, and the very last one is George Smith, still alive.
I know one, but I don't remember the name. In the second row, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
That's Carlyle Beals, and he did a lot of work on both Rayleigh stars.
I don't know.
And he's connected. Good choice, okay. No chocolate. Okay, let's not waste time. I'll tell you who they are later if you're interested. But I'll be mentioning quite a few of their names. Well, this story starts in 1815, and famous German physicist, optical glassmaker, and astronomer, Joseph Fraunhofer, he passed sunlight through a prism, as Newton had done many centuries earlier. But Fraunhofer found that sunlight, when dispersed into a spectrum, gives absorption lines. And this is Fraunhofer's own drawing, showing the intensity distribution as perceived by his eye of the solar spectrum and the different colors, and a whole lot of so-called absorption lines. So he really discovered the lines. He is the first to catalog them. I think William Wollaston had actually seen them and not understood what he was looking at in 1802, but in 1815, Fraunhofer realized the significance of these lines to some extent. He made this drawing with 572 lines in the solar spectrum, where light is missing at rather precise wavelengths. And here is a modern diagram showing some of the Fraunhofer absorption lines seen in the solar spectrum, and very large number. And Fraunhofer gave them these labels, it meant, but he realized there were very precise wavelength markers, which was very useful for testing the optical properties of glass, because he was a very important glass maker. Well, that's Fraunhofer's drawing. If you look at a modern solar spectrum, here's just a very small part of the solar spectrum. You can see there are lots and lots of absorption lines. This is the intensity against wavelength. In a very small region of the solar spectrum and the region of the H beta line in the blue. And there are hundreds of very sharp fine lines which Fraunhofer didn't see. He saw the H beta line of hydrogen, though he didn't know what caused it, which is this thing with great big wings. And the very strongest lines have these wings, where they've been very deep. So, in fact, there are about 10,000 100,000 lines in the spectrum of the sun. And you can look up catalogues of the solar spectrum and see that they're very numerous. Especially at shorter wavelengths in the blue and ultraviolet. But there are quite a few in the yellow and red parts of the spectrum too. Well, how do you produce a spectrum? Here's an entirely schematic diagram showing a spectrograph. A spectrograph is an instrument for recording a spectrum. And to record a spectrum, ideally you want a telescope unless you're observing the sun. Let's say we're observing a star. So the telescope just collects light and images a star here. Let's put a slit, a luminator slit, with a stellar image. And then let's collimate the light so that these... Was someone talking? we'll collimate the light and then pass it through some dispersing element. Originally for Fraunhofer that was a prism. Today, more often than not, we use a diffraction grating. And this is purely schematic, because mostly our diffraction gratings are working in reflection, but just let's not worry about how it works, but it splits up the light, disperses the light, so that different wavelengths go in different directions. For example, blue light can go along this collimated beam, the red light or orange light would be affected in a different direction. And therefore, when you pass that through a camera, which is just an optical element for focusing the slit onto a detector, different wavelengths appear in different places on the detector. So a spectrograph is really just, or a spectrum is just a whole series of slit, monochromatic slit images in a line, continuously varying wavelength. I've just shown two wavelengths, but in fact, there are any number of wavelengths in a continuous spectrum. So that's what a spectrograph does. And it was found, by the first pioneers in stellar spectroscopy, Huggins and Secchi, in the 1860s, who were working visually, that different stars have absorption lines, but they differ very much from each other. And the Sun, we know, is a G star. So here is the spectrum of a G star, and these are positive images. So the absorption lines are these dark things. So that's the solar type of spectrum. But other stars have very different lines or lines of different strength in their spectra. And stars are being classified in this sequence from O to M, which is just a visual description of which absorption lines occur. And we've got these seven different spectral classes, O, B, A, F, G, K, and M, depending on which lines are seen in the spectrum. And the spectral classification scheme, first devised at Harvard over 100 years ago, is based on the blue part of the spectrum. So really, these spectra are black and white, they're not colored. In fact, they go from the ultraviolet or far violet part of the spectrum to the blue, almost green. So a spectral classification done just in that small part of the spectrum. That's very fortunate that most stars have their lines in the blue part of the spectrum, and the early photographic plates, which were the detectors, were sensitive to the blue. So we've got spectral classification. People didn't really understand what it meant, but they classified stars anyway. And at Harvard, they classified about a quarter of a million or more 100 years ago, working with Annie Cannon and others. But then, in Germany, astronomers started measuring the temperatures of stars, and they did that by spectrophotometry in the first instance. And the way they do it is find out what is the total amount of light of all wavelengths and integrated that and compared the total amount of light with that from a black body, which is really a hypothetical concept of physicists. And the emission from a black body per square meter of surface goes as the fourth power of the temperature of that black body. And even if stars don't radiate light, this ideal physical concept of black body, they could measure what they call the effective temperature of stars from spectrophotometry. So that was first done by photographic spectrophotometry in the early years of the 20th century at Potsdam. And then it became clear that there's a very close correlation between the effective temperature of a star, which is a bit like the temperature of the surface layers that you actually see that emit the light, correlation between the effective temperature and the spectral type, which is depends only on the absorption lines presence. So that correlation between line strength or spectral type and temperature of the surface layers is a very important finding 100 years ago. So what it amounts to is that stars of different temperature, or if you like, spectral type, more or less synonymous, have lines of different elements which vary very much from stars of one temperature to another. For example, the hydrogen lines are particularly strong in stars where the temperature in the surface layers is about 10,000 Kelvin. So the hydrogen lines are weak for the very hottest stars, but they reach a maximum, then they fall off again. And other lines of other elements generally go up and down, showing a maximum at some particular temperature. The Roman 2, for example, means ionized. Fe2 is singly ionized iron, Fe1 is neutral iron, Ca1 is neutral calcium, and very cooler stars have molecules, particularly dominant being titanium oxide. And the very hottest stars have multiply ionized, for example, silicon 3 has lost 2 electrons. Silicon 3 is the spectrum of Si++, and silicon 4 is the spectrum of Si, the 3+ lost 3 electrons. So there is a schematic diagram showing that line strength of different elements is very sensitive to temperature. Well, line strength depends mainly on temperature, but temperature is certainly not the only physical parameter which determines how strong these absorption lines are. And essentially, there are 3 other parameters determine line strength. One important one is the abundance of the chemical element producing that line. For example, in the solar spectrum, about half the absorption lines are from neutral iron, Fe1. And it's the ratio of whatever element causes the line to hydrogen, which also determines the line strength. You might wonder why hydrogen. Well, hydrogen by far the most abundant element. And actually, it's the ratio of what we call the line opacity to the continuous opacity. Opacity is the sort of fogginess of the star. When you look at the sun, the radius of the sun is 750,000 kilometers, but we only see into the surface layers of the sun about 300 kilometers. And that's because the gas of the sun is quite opaque. opaque body, and it's the hydrogen which is the cause of the fog. And it's the ratio of the line opacity to the continuous opacity. The line opacity giving the lines from each other, the continuous opacity giving the general opacity, which varies over all wavelengths. And the ratio of line to continuous opacity is, determined by this ratio, the abundance of some element, which I call M. M is general symbol, generic symbol for a metal, and for astronomers, everything is a metal except hydrogen and helium. So it's the abundance of some metal to the source of the continuous opacity, which is hydrogen. Other factors which determine line strength are the gravity. How strong is the gravity in the surface layers where the lines are formed? And also the turbulence, the random velocities. These are not the thermal random velocities, but due to mass motions in the upper layers of stars. So the turbulence, let's call it xi, that's the Greek letter xi, also determines line strength. In some cases, it's fairly minor, subtle effect. So there are four parameters: temperature, more precisely, effective temperature, the surface gravity, the turbulence, and the element abundance. Now, probably the most important and interesting is the element abundance, because we would like to know how abundant are the different elements that occur in nature in different stars. To sort out all those parameters and to actually measure abundances, before we even start the analysis, we should measure the effective temperature, the gravity, and possible the turbulent velocity. And if we can measure all those before we start the analysis of the lines, then we can obtain the fourth parameter, the abundance. It's complicated, first of all, because the temperature is the most sensitive parameter affecting line strength, not the abundance. And some lines are rather insensitive to abundance. And to actually do this analysis, you need a model of the outer layers of a star. By model, I mean how does the temperature, pressure, and other parameters, how do they vary with depth? You have to put all that into a computer and calculate theoretical line strengths and compare the results with the observations. And, for example, if you analyze the chemical abundance of the sun, you find that Fe over H, or log Fe over H, that's the number of iron atoms to hydrogen atoms. By atom, I mean atom or iron, irrespective of ionization state. The ratio of Fe over H is about one atom of iron for every 32,000 of hydrogen. So you can see that even though iron has the richest spectrum, it's only a tiny trace element in the outer layers of the sun. And this is normally expressed logarithmically. Log Fe over H for the sun is about minus 4.5. And iron is one of the richest elements in the sun. So the sun essentially consists of pure hydrogen and helium with just trace amounts of everything else. And iron is one of the more important ones . Well, abundances of elements is one very important thing you can do with spectroscopy. Another is you can measure a star's velocity. And that is through the famous Doppler equation, that there are wavelength shifts. This is a fractional wavelength shift. It is the so-called radial velocity divided by the speed of light. The speed of light is a very large number, 300,000 kilometers per second, and stars move at much smaller velocities. So the wavelength shifts are very, very tiny, and it took Doppler announced this formula in 1842. It took exactly 50 years before a Doppler shift had been measured for any star. And it really required very careful photographic spectroscopy. Let me demonstrate a Doppler shift actually in a spectrum. This is a spectrum of a star which I recorded 10 years or so ago at Mount John. It's a star sun, a little bit hotter than the sun, and has lots of absorption lines, the spectrum is split up into strips. Let's not worry about the technical reason for that. But you can see all these absorption lines, and, I'm just wondering if I can recognize any of them. Probably I can. There are sodium B lines, I think. Well, there are the so-called magnesium B lines in the green. Let's not worry about what the line is. Anyway, you can see the star has many absorption lines. And that was recorded, one of the stars, Zeta Triangulum Australis, and a few days later, I recorded another spectrum. And surprisingly, the lines have all shifted. That's a Doppler shift. And that movement of those lines is because the velocity of that star in the line of sight actually changed by about 15 kilometers per second. Why does it change velocity? Because it's in a binary system. So that's part of the binary star orbit. So there is a Doppler shift. By the way, notice that some of the lines, these ones up here, are not moving. That's because they are telluric lines. They're due to oxygen molecules in the Earth's atmosphere. So they're not changing velocity, but the lines of the star, which is most of those lines, are changing velocity. Well, that's a binary star. And by the way, this we just built our Hercules spectrograph at Mount John. And we're able to get a very precise orbit for that binary. It's this so-called single-lined binary, so two stars orbiting each other, but one that's putting out nearly all the lights, and the fainter star, its spectrum is not observed. But for the brighter star, we see velocity varying up and down, because roughly it's two stars going around each other in circular orbit around that common center of mass. And so it shows a very nice velocity curve due to this orbital motion. Well, the difference in those two spectra were at the peak and the trough, so it's about 15 meters per second from there to there. And we can measure quite easily to 15 meters per second, actually even rather better than that. So that Doppler shift I showed you in those two spectra, we can rather easily measure 1,000 times smaller than that, and they're very, very tiny. Just a few microns on the CCD, a fraction of a pixel, is the typical error bar. You can see the error bars are so small you can't see any scatter in that plot at all. Not in the lower diagram, the scatter is shown in the line. And you can then produce a very nice velocity curve for a binary and get all the orbital parameters. It's roughly a sine curve indicating a circular orbit. Now, I talked about absorption lines. Just a few stars, not many, have emission lines where the light is actually brighter than the continuum. And there are a number of reasons why a star might have emission lines. And in all cases, it's because the temperature is increasing outwards, whereas nearly all stars have temperature increasing inwards. And the condition for absorption lines is actually that temperature gradient. If the temperature increases inwards, which is generally the case, you get absorption lines. But if you have a hot, tenuous outer layer, even hotter than the nominal surface of the star, then you will have emission lines. And there are about three or four different reasons why stars might have hot, tenuous outer layers, which are even hotter than the surface. One type of star with emission lines is called a BE star, the E standing for emission. And they're rapidly rotating stars, which have kind of thrown off an equatorial shell around the star just because of the very rapid rotation of the centrifugal force has flung material off into a disc shape around the star, and that's this tenuous material at fairly high temperature. Sometimes stars are surrounded by a hot, tenuous layer of gas from which the stars formed, and they're called Herbig A, E, and B stars, not due to fast rotation, but just the remnants of the gas. And George Herbig, whose picture I showed you, discovered this category of emission line star. Then there are novae and supernovae, which have thrown off gas in a shell as a result of an explosion. And then there are stars with strong magnetic fields, and even the sun is a bit like this, and they have a chromospheric layer. Generally, it comes from stars with fast rotation, also have strong magnetic fields, and they have this chromospheric layer, which is tenuous gas supported in magnetic field loops. And stars with very strong magnetic fields have stronger chromosphere. And the chromosphere is the source of emission lines. In the sun, the chromospheric emission is always there, but it's very weak compared with the light from the photosphere, which is the layer below this chromospheric layer. Here, for example, is the spectrum of Nova, a star which is ejected through an explosive event, a tenuous shell of gas around it. And you can see both absorption and emission lines. For example, the H alpha line in the red is in emission. Here is the continuum, and very strong emission line. H beta, also hydrogen in emission. Many of these lines, you'll see a characteristic shape. There is an emission feature. Here's an ionized nitrogen line. And on the short wavelength side, there's an absorption feature. That's called a P Cygni profile, with absorption and emission lines of the same element. And the P Cygni profile is caused by an expanding shell of gas. So that's spectrum of a nova. And here are some stars with strong chromospheric emission due to magnetic fields. 70 of Yuki is one of these active chromosphere stars. This is the K-line of ionized calcium, very, very broad, very big wings. And in the center of the K-line is this emission due to the chromosphere. And the emission has a double peak. Actually, the chromosphere is sufficiently opaque. It gives its own absorption line, chromospheric absorption in the center. Many of its emission line. Well, that's Cynthia-Fiuki, an active chromosphere star. Alpha Centauri B is not an active chromosphere star, but still has K-line emission in the very center and bottom of the photospheric absorption line. So there's the emission from the chromosphere, that double peak. And in the sun, it's a bit like Alpha Centauri B, but the K emission is even weaker still. I mentioned the fast rotating BE stars. Here is a diagram of the BE star drawn by Arne Sletterbeck in 1979. There's the photosphere of the star. This very tenuous but hotter disc-shaped thing, and the star is rotating very fast, maybe several hundred kilometers per second at the equator, about rotation axis, which is vertical. And this circumstellar disk gives rise to these emission lines. But the appearance of emission lines depends on whether you observe them rotation axis face on, or at an oblique angle, or edge on to the disk. You get different profiles of the emission lines. Well, that's a schematic diagram. Here are some real BE star spectra of the H alpha line in emission, generally double peaked from each side of the disk. Because if you're seeing a disk edge on, this side is going away from the observer, this side towards, so that would give a redshift distribution. So there's the BE star. Now, one of the things you can do from interstellar spectra is measure the surface gravity. We all have an idea of what gravity means here on the Earth. We know that gravity here on the surface of the Earth is just under 10 meters per second per second, which is due to the acceleration due to gravity. We measure the gravitational field. That's on the surface of the Earth. But on the surface of the Sun, the acceleration due to gravity is 274 meters per second per second, about 30 times greater. So if you stand on the surface of the Sun, you'll weigh about 30 times as much as you do here on Earth. Of course, there are other consequences for doing that. Just happens that most stars are what we call dwarf stars, including the Sun, and the gravity of the surface of dwarf stars is, just happens to be about the same. So the hotter dwarf stars, like Sirius, they are more massive than the Sun, but they're also larger radius. And the gravity goes as mass over radius squared. And mass over radius squared is roughly constant for main sequence stars or dwarf stars. So the gravity of dwarf stars is plus or minus factor of 2, is the same as that of the Sun, this value here. Usually it's expressed logarithmically and in centimeters per second per second. So the gravity of the Sun is log g is 4.44. And most dwarf stars are around 4.5 or so. However, there's a category of stars which are much larger than dwarfs, about typically 10 times larger. So mass over radius squared is 100 times smaller. So typical gravity of a dwarf star is about 3 meters per second per second. And the supergiants are the biggest build, with gravities 10 or 100 times less than 3 meters per second per second. We can measure gravity from the spectrum. There are several ways of doing it, but I'm going to just mention one way. Here's the H gamma absorption line in a spectrum of a supergiant, there in a giant, and there in a dwarf. It's pretty obvious what's happening. The wings are much stronger in the dwarf stars. Why is that? Because when the gravity is stronger, the pressures are stronger. Imagine that gravity is sort of squeezing the whole atmosphere of the star, increasing the pressure, and the hydrogen atoms in the outer layers of the star are crashing into each other and disturbing the energy levels. These absorption lines come from electron transitions when atoms go from one level to another. But if the levels are disturbed, they don't have precise energy levels anymore. Therefore, the atoms of each element, including hydrogen, can absorb over a range of energies or a range of wavelengths. And instead of being one precise energy or wavelength for the absorption, there's a whole range of values. And that is manifested by these wings. So the high pressure stars show what we call pressure broadening. If we have a model, we can model that and measure the gravity. And here are some images of photographic spectra. And you can see that the dwarfs, there's an A-type dwarf, has broad hydrogen lines, whereas this one is a supergiant, and the lines are much sharper. So you can see that the wings are actually... So we can measure gravity from spectra. It's a fairly subtle effect, but at least the strong lines show it quite clearly. And you have to produce models, and here is a model. Log G equals 2 means 100 centimeters per second per second. Dwarf stars like the Sun are more like log G equals 4, even greater than that still. So there are very significant differences produced by models for the wings of the strong lines. Now, turbulence also affects line strength. It's a fairly subtle effect. The atoms in the outer layers of a star are in motion for two reasons. One is just the random thermal motions of the atoms, but also there may be mass motions. Imagine cells of gas in random motions. And random motion produces a differential Doppler effect for different cells of gas, and therefore the lines are broader. Here, we've got 8 kilometers per second random velocities. Here, only the thermal random velocities. But if you add mass motions, the lines are broader. Now, turbulence always broadens lines. For some lines, it makes them stronger as well. In other words, there's more light absorbed. And I won't go into the physics of why some lines, but only some lines, are strengthened by turbulence. It's a fairly subtle effect. But you have to understand the physics of that if you are to turn line strengths into abundances of elements, which is what we're really interested in. And by the way, there's another phenomenon which can broaden lines, and that's the rotation of a star. If a star is rotating, one hemisphere of the star will be coming towards us, the other away from us, and that will also broaden lines, but it doesn't strengthen them. And here is the effect of rotation. It's not, these are assumed to be Gaussian profiles. Rotational broadening, you can see very clearly it's not Gaussian, it's a combination, it's more like an ellipse or a parabola, that combination of both. And there is a star which is not rotating at all. This star at the equator has 80 kilometers per second of rotational velocity, seen edge on. So the line can very wash it out. Let me briefly summarize what's really interesting from stellar spectroscopy, and that's measuring the abundances of the different elements. So let's suppose we take a million atoms of hydrogen from some given star, and for a million, that's log n equals to 12, 10 to the 12th, how many atoms of the other elements will there be relative to hydrogen? The answer is most stars have 10 times less helium by number than hydrogen, so helium log n for helium is 11. Roughly speaking, that's helium there. Then we've got three elements with incredibly low abundances, lithium, beryllium, and boron, which is roughly sort of 10 to the 10 times less than hydrogen. Then the next most abundant elements are carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, neon, and also quite abundant is iron, which I mentioned before for the sun is 32,000 times less, or about minus 4.5. So you can see on this scale, if log hydrogen is 12, iron then sits at 7.5. So there is iron. And it turns out that nearly all stars, quite remarkably, have about the same composition chemically. There are exceptions, but the vast majority of stars, probably 95%, have a composition very similar to the sun, even though their spectra are so very different from one star to another. That's a temperature effect, not an abundance effect. And that, it took astronomers 100 years to come to that conclusion. Stars have very different spectra, they're all about the same composition. And it's really only been in the last 60 years that reliable abundances of elements have been found. You notice that the abundant elements tend to be the light ones, apart from lithium, beryllium, and boron. And as you go to the heavier elements, the abundances get less and less. So the time you get down to uranium, it has only tiny amounts. You need a million atoms of hydrogen. You might not even have one of uranium in the sun and other stars. Well, that's element abundance against atomic number. If you do it against atomic weight, then you start looking at the different isotopes, and you see the same sort of pattern. A very important iron peak appears in both diagrams. There's the iron peak. And you see a very clear odd-even effect in both diagrams, that the even-numbered elements are more abundant than the neighboring odd-numbered ones. But overall, there's a general trend from carbon to uranium going downwards. When you plot against atomic weight, you see a number of very interesting little peaks, which are clues to how the elements were actually formed in the universe. Now, I'm going to take a commercial break, because a few years ago I wrote this book, which is, some of you have seen it already, so I won't dwell on it too much. But in this book, this is the second edition, and it described the development of stellar spectroscopy from Fraunhofer to, the first edition to 1970, the second edition to the year 2000. So this book took the first edition plus the next 30 years of the 20th century from 1970 to 2000. And that's why in this talk, I'm going to tell you what I've found to be the most interesting discoveries in stellar spectroscopy in the last three decades of the 20th century. And this is my opinion after searching the second edition, obviously. If you want to buy a copy, it's $120 on Amazon. US dollars, I'm afraid. In the 20th century, the rate of astronomical publication has increased as time has gone on. And for most of the 20th century, there were about 14, 15, 16,000 papers per decade published in astronomy, in the referee astronomical literature. But from about 1960 onwards, it started rising. And in fact, most of the papers, let me say this, the more papers have been published in the last three decades of the 20th century than in all of astronomical history before 1970. So that's an incredible increase. You might say, well, isn't that amazing? We must know so much more about the stars and the result of the research of the last three decades. And that rate, has, by the way, has increased. It didn't suddenly stop in the year 2000. For example, I did count the number of papers published in 2001 to 10. It was 239,017. So the increase is accelerated. I haven't done the count for the second decade, or it hasn't even finished yet. Anyway, so I'm going to tell you about what were the main discoveries in these papers, and I'm going to skip that slide. So how many papers were there? I think there were about almost 500,000 in those last three decades. Before I describe what I think are the most important discoveries from stellar spectroscopy in those last three decades, there are a number of instrumental developments that spurred the type of research that astronomers could do. And I'm going to highlight three very important instrumental developments. One is a kind of diffraction grating, which has revolutionized astronomy, called the A-shell grating. And an A-shell grating has a number of grooves ruled in a surface, and the grooves run parallel to the shorter side of this A-shell grating. And the grooves have a profile such as the light falls on the grating at an oblique angle, perhaps 60 or 70 degrees, even 75. So this is the grating that we use in the Hercules spectrograph of Mount John, 204 by 408 millimeters. So the A-shell grating was used for getting a high dispersion spectrum of starlight, and it's enabled very compact spectrographs like this one that we built for Mount John. In fact, we built this in 1977. It's a Cassegrain A-shell, and it allows a high dispersion instrument. It used to be a big instrument that would fill this whole room. Now it could just go at the Cassegrain focus, and that spectrograph is less than a meter long. So shell gratings were very useful for high dispersion work. The second big development in instrumentation I want to comment on is the use of optical fibers. Instead of mounting a spectrograph at the Cass focus, why not put a star image there and let the light spectrograph through a fiber, a few tens of meters long, and put the spectrograph in a really stable environment where it's not flapping around in the breeze on the end of a telescope, but firmly controlled. For example, that spectrograph we built at Mount John, we put in later on into a thermal chamber, and the light came in through the optical fiber, which you can see at the top. And there's a CCD detector down the bottom with the nitrogen. So this was now in a stable environment and was not flexing as the telescope would move around the sky. So optical fibers have revolutionized the measurement of Doppler shifts, especially. If you want to measure a Doppler shift, which might just be a micron or two on a CCD, you don't want the whole spectrograph to be flexing by 10 or 100 microns. And the third big instrumental development, the CCD itself, and those two gentlemen I mentioned before, Willard Boyle and George Smith, they invented the CCD about 1970, or 69 in fact, Bell Labs. They got the Nobel Prize in 2009. And the CCD, as everyone here knows, I'm sure, has revolutionized stellar spectroscopy, in fact, all branches of astronomy. For 100 years, astronomers were doing photographic detection of spectra. In fact, when I trained as an astronomer, I found all these wonderful techniques working in dark rooms with photographic plates, which astronomers never touch these days. And the change was very sudden after 100 years of photography from about 1980 onwards. Suddenly we're doing CCD digital detectors and sending the data straight to computer. And the first stellar spectroscopy followed about 10 years after the first CCD, about 1980, at Peak Observatory, Ingemar Fuhlenried and Michael Snowden, whom many of you may know, which is in New Zealand, were the first people ever to do stellar spectroscopy for the CCD. And having digital detection has made all the difference. If you combine all those three instrumental developments into one, then you have a fiber-fed Echelle spectrograph of a CCD detector. And one of the most famous early ones was this one called ALOD. ALOD was at Haute-Provence Observatory and also at ESO. And then Parkes went to ESO for very precise measurements in the first extrasolar planet. Came from Everly, 51 paper. Parkes was the later development. And this is the back end of the Hercules spectrograph at Mount John, which, by the way, was the world's first vacuum fiber-fed Echelle spectrograph. So these are vacuum tanks, so the light is dispersed in the vacuum. Increases the stability. Two other interesting developments are the introduction of infrared arrays. They're a bit like CCDs, but each pixel has its own independent electronics for amplification. And so infrared arrays revolutionized infrared stellar spectroscopy. And for example, the discovery of brown dwarfs was made possible. And I'll say a bit more about brown dwarfs very soon. And also spectroscopy of stars from space, starting with satellites such as TD1 and the orbiting astronomical observatory number 3 called Copernicus, launched by NASA, and especially the UK and American IUE, International Ultraviolet Explorer, one of the world's most successful astronomical satellites, lasted 18 years. It was just before the CCD era. Television cameras instead of CCDs, but still had a Shell grating with some very rare instances. And on the Hubble Space Telescope, the first high resolution spectrograph was called the Goddard High Res Spectrograph. It lasted a few years on Hubble before being replaced. And it revolutionized ultraviolet stellar spectroscopy. If you want to observe the ultraviolet, you have have to go above the stratosphere. So, now, what were the most important discoveries from the telespectroscopy? How much time have they got, Bill?
Well, we usually finish around 9 before we do Q&A.
I need another 10 or 15 minutes.
Oh, yeah, that's fine.
I just got a list here in the order of importance. Discovery of extrasolar planets. I'm going to say a few words about each of them. Discovery of brown dwarfs. The evidence for stellar mass black holes, such as Cygnus Hexagon. The discovery of coronal gas in the interstellar medium. Very hot gas, temperature of 1,000,000 degrees. The analysis of supernova 1987A spectra, by far the most analyzed and observed supernova in the history of astronomy. The introduction of cosmochronology, measuring the ages of stars by radioactive decay, just as people measure the age of rocks on Earth by uranium and thorium finds. Abundances. You can measure the abundances of uranium and thorium in stars and find out the age of the stars. Discovery and analysis of very metal poor stars. People have been trying to find stars with no heavy elements or no metals at all. This so-called hypothetical population 3 stars. And it's been a treasure hunt to find stars very, very deficient in elements. For many years, stars Fe of H in square brackets, that means iron to hydrogen relative to the sun. So 10 to the minus 4 of the solar iron to hydrogen ratio. For many years that was the record low, now we're down to minus 5. Measuring the abundance of stars of different age and showing that the Milky Way galaxy has had its metallicity or heavy element content increase the time, so the oldest stars are metal poor relative to the sun, and the very youngest stars are metal rich. So the metallicity enrichment, iron, hydrogen, but other elements as well, are slowly going up in the interstellar medium, and of course it's the interstellar medium on which stars form. Then my ninth most important discovery is the analysis of lithium in stars. Lithium is a very interesting element, because it's actually destroyed in stars. You put lithium into a star, its protons at 1,000,000 degrees destroy lithium. So the lithium abundance should go down in stars, especially old stars, because lithium, after a billion years, you would think would all be destroyed by protons. But the discovery that some of the very oldest stars are lithium rich has been an extraordinary discovery. Let's start with extrasolar planets. I think it's probably the most exciting discovery from stellar spectroscopy in 1995. Michel Mayor from Geneva and Jeff Marcy from Berkeley, actually mainly Michel, found the radial velocity variation of the solar type star going up and down every 4.2 days. And they said this must be because the star has a Jupiter mass planet orbiting it. And in fact, it's about half a Jupiter mass every 4.23 days. And that was the discovery of the first real extrasolar planet. I think some pulsars had planets going around and discovered a little bit earlier, but they're really funny stars. So this is a real star with a real planet.
Which method did they use?
Oh, this is the pulsars. Well, this is from radial velocity technique. You can see that velocity of 51K is changing. So
here's the mass.
Here's a star, here's a planet,
star
is wobbling.
Which method?
Yes, the radial velocity method, the Doppler technique. So the velocity variations are just tens of meters per second, so you need to measure velocity very, very precisely. And that's why a fiber-fed Schell spectrograph with a CCD detector is actually essential. And this would never have been done in the photographic era before CCDs and before optical fibers and Schell grains. But all three instrumental developments came together, and that was 1995. Brown dwarfs are low-mass objects, sometimes called failed stars. They're not hot enough for nuclear fusion reactions, which is why most stars are shining. And the first brown dwarfs, which have long been sought and hypothesized, now actually discovered by photometry. However, spectroscopy came in because brown dwarfs, being very low temperature objects, have quite different spectra from stars. And it was necessary to introduce new spectral types. Remember, for stars, the coolest stars are called M-type stars. M-type stars have especially titanium oxide bands of absorption. The temperatures on the surface of that's 2 to 4,000 Kelvin. But L dwarfs are the brown dwarfs of lower mass than stars, and a very rare category, the T dwarfs, are the coolest types with temperatures less than 1,300 Kelvin. So Daly Kirkpatrick, by the way, Caltech, is the one of the great pioneers in M dwarf spectroscopy. And here are some spectra at low resolution of brown dwarfs. This is what's truly up. This is an M dwarf, a star with various oxides in these absorption features. Here is an L dwarf, which is dominated by hydrides, iron hydride, chromium hydride, magnesium hydride, calcium, and very strong potassium and sodium lines. Most of these lines are in the infrared, so you've got to do the spectroscopy at near infrared wavelengths, around a micron. And then the very rare T dwarfs have spectra rather like that of Jupiter, actually, with methane and also water vapor. So new spectral types. Here is the first real evidence for a stellar mass black hole. It's a binary system containing an O-type supergiant and stellar mass black hole. And there's a great big accretion disk, and the gas is being sucked off the supergiant by tidal forces. It's falling through a big gravitational potential. The accretion disk gets very hot, therefore it's an X-ray source. Well, when you're looking at optical light, you see this, the supergiant, B-type supergiant. And we know that B-type supergiants have a mass about 10 times greater than the Sun, so that's the conclusion that this radial velocity variation of that star is because it's orbiting an invisible object. And you can do the solution for the orbit and find the mass of this object. And it turns out it has to be at least 2.5 times the mass of the Sun. That's a lower limit, and we don't know what the angle, the orientation of this object is to the line of sight, so maybe 2.5 solar masses if seen edge on, but even more than that if it was seen at some oblique angle. What can it be that emits no light but is 2.5 times the mass of the Sun or more? The answer is a black hole. So that was the first real evidence by Louise Webster, who was Australian, by the way, and Paul Merton from Britain, who published that paper in 1972. The discovery of coronal gas in the interstellar medium, also a very interesting result. This was done by ultraviolet spectroscopy from the Copernicus satellite in 1972, and by other ultraviolet satellites since then. And if you look at a distant star through interstellar space is not empty, it is full of gas. Some of that gas is neutral hydrogen, but there are clouds of very high temperature but very low density gas called the coronal gas, I suppose by analogy with the corona of the Sun. And it was discovered in the ultraviolet that five times ionized oxygen, in other words, the spectrum of O6, can be observed in some distant B stars in the galactic plane. We're looking through a lot of gas. So there's the discovery of this coronal component in the interstellar medium. And the temperature is, to get such a high degree of ionization, is of the order of 200,000 to 2 million degrees. So space is filled with gas. Most of it's not coronal gas, but there are these large clouds of very high temperature, low density gas. Supernovae, well, supernova 1987A, we did a program at Mount John. Alan Gilmore was the main observer, and we produced an atlas of spectra of supernova 1987A. There is the H-alpha line, very early, and is going later and later. The line profile has changed shape. This is a P-Cygni profile, emission and absorption in H-alpha. We can measure the velocity of the expanding shell of gas, starting off about nearly 20,000 kilometers per second and falling off to about 5,000 kilometers per second. I guess it's a little expanded. These two people, Jules Kerel and Roger Kerel, French astronomers. I worked in Paris with them for several years, so I know them well. And Roger Kerel here introduced this technique of cosmochronology. He is the first person to measure the uranium abundance in a very old star. In fact, in any star, and the uranium is very hard to detect in the spectrum. There is the absorption line of uranium. That's that sort of dip. It was right in the wing of a strong iron line. It makes it very hard to measure the strength. But anyway, he did it and estimated the uranium abundance. Now, uranium has a half-life of 4.5 gigayears. Thorium is much more stable, still radioactive, with a half-life of 14.1 gigayears. And therefore, as a star ages, the uranium-to-thorium ratio goes down. You can work out how old the star is, provided you can estimate how much uranium and thorium was there originally. Well, that comes from supernova theory. Those elements probably come from supernova explosions. So you can work out the age of the star, and this star, CS310821, they estimated an age of about 12.5 gigayears. In other words, just about as old as the Milky Way itself. So that was another very important discovery. The very most metal poor stars, this star held the record for this star held the record for low abundance for many, many years. And that's the name of the star in the quarterly catalog. And its iron to hydrogen ratio relative to the sun about 10 to the minus 4.5. Or later revised to minus 4. So 10,000 times less iron than in the sun. So that was the record most metal deficient star, and the low iron is measured, just about all the heavy elements are down by the same factor. And there is the spectrum. You see the lines are much, much weaker than the normal abundant star of the same spectral type. So that's an abundance effect. Well, today there's a star with about 100,000 times less iron than the sun, and it's this one here, which was discovered in 2004. Also by Mike Bessel, by the way, at the Australian National University, Mike Stromberg. So Mike Bessel worked on both these very metal poor stars. But no star has yet been found with zero metallicity, where the absorption lines are actually absent. The metallicity of stars increases as time goes on. Or if you go back in time, stars on average in the disk of the Milky Way are more metal poor, but there's a lot of scatter. And there have been a number of studies showing that the older stars are more metal poor in the galactic disk, but not hugely. Minus 0.5 is about three times less heavy elements than in the Sun. Zero means solar abundance. So if you go back a billion years, you're down by a factor of three. So it's just a slow enrichment of the interstellar medium in metals. Why is that? Because supernovae are the source of those metals, and every time a supernova explodes, it puts more iron and other heavy elements into the interstellar medium, from which the younger stars form. So the enrichment of the interstellar medium is a very important part of galactic evolution. And finally, I mentioned lithium. Well, lithium, we think, is formed in cosmic rays crashing into the interstellar medium. Some lithium comes from the Big Bang, so it has different ways it can form. But as soon as lithium gets incorporated into stars, then it's destroyed by protons above about a million degrees. So the lithium can get convected down into deep layers, then it's destroyed, and then the absence of lithium can be convected up again to the surface, where we see very weak, there's only one lithium line in the spectrum of any star, it's in the red, and it's there. That is a lithium absorption line, incredibly weak in the Sun and most other stars. Well, if lithium is destroyed over a billion years or so in stars, you might expect the older stars to have no lithium at all. And what two French astronomers called Francois and Monique Speed, husband and wife, there they are, what they discovered is some of the very oldest stars indeed have quite strong lithium. How could that be if lithium is destroyed in stars? First of all, let me say that lithium increases in abundance as time goes on in the interstellar medium because of cosmic rays. So cosmic rays crash into the interstellar medium and break off fragments of atoms. Some of those fragments are lithium. So it's not formed in stars, it's formed in the interstellar medium and in the Big Bang. So the lithium abundance go up. But here we've got very old stars with quite a high abundance of lithium, provided they weren't very cool. And the interpretation of this result is that these very old stars, called population 2 stars, the low abundance of elements, such as iron, must somehow suppress the convection so the lithium is not convected down to deeper, hotter layers where it's destroyed. And that was not expected at all. So there is the so-called Speed Plateau. This flat area with rather high lithium abundance in these very old stars. So the Speed Plateau means that convection has been suppressed in the outer layers of some of these old stars. That's an abundance effect because the very low abundance of iron and other elements has meant that convection is not so efficient. So there's another interesting discovery from stellar spectroscopy. What I've not said anything about is all the work on stellar spectroscopy with variable stars and binary stars and peculiar stars. Just a huge amount of work. There's so many different types of stars with unusual spectra. I'm not going to just list some of these abnormalities, just so they know they exist. And binary stars, symbiotic stars are a kind of binary star. So just a huge variety of spectroscopic anomalies and binary stars also. Barium stars, for example, are stars with very strong barium lines, and were discovered by Robert McClure in Canada that they are all in binaries. what can we conclude? In the 20th century, there were 546,427 refereed papers in astronomy. Now, they weren't all on stellar spectroscopy. I haven't done an analysis of how many were about spectra of stars. The ABS website will very quickly tell you how many papers were published altogether. And about 80% of them were published in the last three decades of the 20th century, 413, 341, 75% anyway. The major advances in technology were ASHA operations, optical fibers, CT detectors, infrared arrays important for the brown dwarfs, ultraviolet spectroscopy important, for example, for the O6 lines seen in the ultraviolet and for the coronal gas. The greatest discoveries, I think, were the discovery of extrasolar planets, of brown dwarfs with the spectral types LMT, stellar mass black holes, and coronal gas. Although the number of papers has doubled in the last three decades, the number of great discoveries, and I think I gave a talk in this room maybe 2 or 3 years ago,
yeah,
I can't remember,
yeah,
saying that the number of discoveries have not kept pace with the number of papers. So papers getting more and more devalued. And in the old days, people published a paper that was something useful to read about. These days, very often, sadly, that's not the case. But you can never be sure, because no one has any chance of reading the sort of quarter of a million papers published in a decade at present. So that's the story of stellar spectroscopy. Thank you very much.
Questions from the audience before we wrap it up. I had a question about, oh, we've got one at the back, just beat you to it.
Yes.
I had a question about the spectrographs with the fiber optic. Presumably, if you were interesting stars in the same field as the one you had the fiber optic on, you can have more than one fiber optic, but you have to go feed each to a different spectrograph. Does anyone do that sort of thing? So you can
multi-object spectroscopy with fibers is a very important thing, because
it's
mainly done at low and perhaps medium dispersion. Whereas if you're doing high dispersion, generally it's one, not always, but generally just one star at a time.
Right.
So people are now doing thousands of spectra simultaneously in star clusters or galaxy clusters. But generally, spectrum is just one little strip. With high dispersion, you break it in a shell spectrum, you break it down into many different orders. And that one star can completely fill your CCD with that. Have I answered your question?
Yes, you did.
Right.
You mentioned a couple of times in the cooler M stars you get elemental titanium and titanium oxide. Do you get titanium dioxide?
No.
Is there a reason for that? Is it a temperature thing?
Do you get titanium dioxide on Earth?
Yes, definitely.
It must be that the Earth is cooler than stars. It must be a temperature thing. I'm not an astrochemist, but there's the monoxides, which are quite prevalent in stars, but not dioxide, not at all.
In the interstellar medium, is it just that there's nothing for it to dissipate into? Or what does it stay hot?
In general, there are several phases in the interstellar medium. Nowhere in the disk of the galaxy is empty, and there are dense molecular clouds, there are neutral hydrogen clouds, there's coronal gas, there's also a hot neutral hydrogen phase, so at least four phases, and there's a very tight correlation between density and temperature. lower density gas is the hottest. That's because the gas is gaining energy from shock waves, from supernovae or from the wind from hot stars, but it's losing energy through emission lines in the infrared. And the very low density gas can't lose energy because of that energy loss process requires collisions between the particles. So if the collisions are very rare, which they are at the incredibly low densities, it's really got no way of reaching temperature equilibrium unless the temperature is very high. So that's why there's this relationship between density and temperature. So in the very simplest model of mean stellar medium, you assume the pressure, and the ideal gas law is the pressure is the number density of particles times Boltzmann's constant K times T. P is NKT. If the simplest model is that there's pressure equilibrium, actually it's not entirely true, but never mind. You can assume that there's pressure equilibrium, so the disk of the galaxy is full of these gas of different phases, but all at the same pressure. And it's, if T is high, physics, really.
In relation to that previous question, in interstellar medium and this very rare rarity, is this speaking of Rydberg atoms?
I didn't quite catch the question.
Are these Rydberg atoms that are in the interstellar medium?
Sergei is the one who should answer this, but those atoms are in so-called H2 regions,
yes.
Is that right?
Yes.
And they are regions close to hot stars where they're receiving ultraviolet photons from the stars and exciting the hydrogen to very high energy states. So the electron in the hydrogen is still bound to a proton, but not in its ground state, but in much higher energy states.
Thank you.
So, but that's only in these hot, so-called H2 regions, where the temperature is maybe 9,000 Kelvin in the infrared gas.
Do you have a quick question, Richard?
Yeah. You said that the T brown dwarfs spectrum is a little bit similar to Jupiter.
Yes.
Is there, in fact, a clear difference between those and orphan planets that are just big orphan?
Well, brown dwarfs tend to be warmer than planets, and that's because, although they don't have nuclear reactions in their center, except for the destruction of deuterium, they're slowly gravitationally shrinking, so they get gravitational energy, which gives them warmth. So their temperatures are 1 or 2,000 Kelvin, that sort of temperature. Planets like Jupiter, I guess, are a bit colder, so the spectrum is not identical to Jupiter, but Jupiter certainly has methane in the spectrum, so the T-type spectrum type around Pluto. So there's some similarity, but not identical.
Okay, we'll take this one more question, we'll take one more question before we stop for supper down or down the Matt Reiki room tonight. Any other questions or otherwise we'll finish? Okay. Thanks again very much.